Thank you for joining us today. 2020 and the start of 2021 has been a very difficult time for the world, our country, and our community. While the format of this year's celebration looks very different, the message is the same and just as important as previous years. Dr. Martin Luther King said, "We must learn to live together as brothers or perish together as fools." Those words ring extremely relevant today. So, I ask each of you to reach your hand out this year and take your neighbor's hand as we continue to build that bridge of unity for our community. Find your individual ways to take that hand throughout the year by having conversations, showing acts of kindness, and seeking to understand what it truly feels like to walk a day in their shoes. Through this commitment to create that bridge of unity, we will virtually march hand in hand today. We will march into 2021. We will walk hand in hand, black, white, yellow, brown, rich, poor, young, old, men, women, children, teachers, students, administrators, police officers, firefighters, and citizens. We will represent the different races, genders, religions, and political parties of our community. We will come together as one to show the unity and diversity of this community. We will march on because we care and we want to continue the work of Dr. Martin Luther King. We want our community to be a community that does not judge by the color of skin, but by the content of each person's character. We want our community to represent King's dream. You are that dream today. Seek every day to build that bridge of unity in our community. Commit to do your part to make our community, nation, and world a better place for all. Let us march on with courage and optimism in an effort to realize King's dream. Let our community be that example of how to live together as brothers. March on.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Westchester Police Chief Joel Herzog. Normally, I get to greet you at the clock tower on a freezing cold January day to start our walk of unity. Today, unfortunately, we're not able to do that. But that does not mean any less of what can happen throughout the year. This is merely one day where we show our commitment and we carry that out throughout the year. The love that is shown throughout the Westchester and Liberty communities is tremendous, but there's always room for improvement, always room for growth. Take this and what you learned from the programs today and carry it throughout the year. Let's all be one. Let's be the example community and shine into 2021. May all you have a safe and healthy new year.
Hello, Westchester. I'm your Fire Chief Rick Prince. I want to welcome everyone to the annual Martin Luther King Day event. On this day, we remember Martin Luther King and honor his legacy, his call for peace and unity. Although we cannot be physically together to march in his honor and to promote his beliefs, we are together as one community, as one big family. Together we can and we will overcome. Enjoy your day.
I'd like to welcome you to our Live the Dream virtual event. It is our community celebration of Martin Luther King Day, and I'm glad that you have joined us today. Please be sure to look at the Live the Dream website to find out about all of the following activities that are going to be taking place after this event is over. We'd love for you to participate in our virtual March for Unity. Please take selfies or video of yourself and post them to our website or to Twitter or Facebook with the hashtag MLKDayWCL. We're grateful for the work of all the community members who have helped to put this together, including John Johns, who has done the work of putting together the virtual choir. I invite you to bow your head as we observe the invocation. Mighty Creator, all that you have made, you love. Help us to find ways to love one another and to revel in our uniqueness and celebrate our differences as we mirror the great and loving inclusion that you give to all that you have created. Bless our time, and bless all who are watching this virtual Live the Dream event today. All this we ask in your name. Amen. Now I'm pleased to present the superintendent of Lakota Schools, Matt Miller, and the owner of Choice Hotels, Ray Murray, as they present our award winners.
We are proud to recognize this year's student winners for the 2021 Reinventing Reforms Contest.
We extend our most sincere congratulations to the following award recipient. Representing the early childhood school category is Carolyn Hoover, a second grader in Mrs. Ryle's class at Wyandotte's ECS.
Hello, my name is Caroline Hoover, and the title of my story is called Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Me. Let me share what I wrote. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. brought about many needed changes to our country. He was generous and also very brave too. He was a hero to all. Dr. MLK Jr. wanted to turn the world upside down. He wanted to change the world and make it a better place. I can make sure that people and children are treating others how they want to be treated. I can give food to people who don't have food or homes. I can also make sure that no one is left out in games or sports. I can also not let people or children make fun of others. I can help all people or children get along nicely, and that everyone is being nice to one another. Thank you for listening. Goodbye.
Congratulations to our elementary level winners. Elementary Fine Art winner Nikki Back, a third grade homeschool student who is winning this award for the third time in a row. Elementary Special Merit winner Brandon Pfeffer, a sixth grade student in Mrs. Jones's class at Independence Elementary. Elementary English Language Learner winner, Laura Rivera Joya, a sixth grader in Mrs. Harvey's class at Independence Elementary.
My artwork demonstrates the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King of treating everybody the same. That when we help someone, we don't pick and choose based on their race, religion, or gender, because we all bleed the same. Thank you.
Our lives begin at the end of the day. We become silent about things that matter. Dr. Luther King Jr. We are all responsible for making ourselves better. If we see a problem, we shouldn't be silent. We should always stand up for what matters. For me, standing up for what matters means doing three things: treating people equally, talking and interacting with everyone, and standing up for people who are getting bullied or hurt. To start off with, treating people equally is the most important part of us standing up for what matters. We are all different, but sometimes people are treated differently for things that they cannot control. For example, some people get treated differently just how they look. They could have a different color of skin, or they could have a deformity. This can make them feel unwanted and left out if we don't stand up for them. Additionally, another way we can stand up for what matters is by taking and interacting with everyone. By including everyone, we might change their lives. Many people are lonely, but you don't always know by looking at them. You could help them up if they fall, or give them a few dollars if they're short. Most importantly, just being there with a thumbs up for support can make a big difference. The final way we can stand up for what matters is by standing up against hatred and bullies. No one deserves to be abused or yelled at. If you see someone that you are in a position to help, you could always help. Being an ally and a friend could start a trend that shows bullies are not wanted. In conclusion, it is amazing by that simply standing up for what matters can completely change a person's life. It is more amazing that the person who is changed is not always the person being helped.
The time is always right to do what is right. This quote is one of the most popular quotes that Dr. King said. Let me tell you a little bit of background about Dr. King. Some of his achievements include being the first president of the SCLC. The second is that he led the Birmingham Companion. Third, he was an instrumental in organizing the Great March in Washington. Fourth, King's speech intensified the civil rights movement. I will follow Dr. King's principles by respecting other people. If something would go wrong, I would handle it in a nonviolent way. Also, if I see someone being unjust, I would step in. I choose to be respectful to everyone, because if I wouldn't, I would probably have problems with that person. So I choose to respect all people. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said about this topic is, we must learn to live together as brothers or perish together as fools. This quote is kind of an event in my life. For example, if my friend likes someone else or disagrees with something that I say, I would respect their decision and not make a big deal about it. Also, if I believe that we should all respect each other and never judge one another by either their skin or how they act. I said that I would handle things in a nonviolent way because it's hurtful to others. Also, there will probably be problems between me and that person. Martin Luther King Jr. talked about dealing this in a nonviolent way. Nonviolence is a powerful and just weapon, which cuts without wounding and enables the man who wields it. It is a sword that heals. King said this because in his 1958 book, Stride Toward Freedom, he talked about the principles of nonviolence. This also pulls in my life because when someone makes me mad, I would think twice before dealing with it violently. I would step in if someone was being unjust because I wouldn't just leave that person there and not do anything about it. I would stand up to that person. There are many injustices in the world right now, but I'm just going to name two. Hunger and food insecurities.
are injustice in the world because the majority of those people with food insecurities are smallholder farmers. Gun violence is injustice in the world because gun violence is a tragedy that people deal with around the world. These are how I can accomplish Dr. King's principles. By respecting other people, if someone would go wrong, I would handle it in a nonviolent way. Also, if I see someone being unjust, I would step in. What principles will you follow from Dr. King?
Our overall elementary winner, Kiri Smith, 6th grade, Mrs. Jones class, Independence Elementary.
Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. Martin Luther King Jr. When I hear this quote, I think of the phrase, two wrongs won't make a right. It means that being mean will not result in anything good. You have to be nice. As a 6th grader, things I can do to help with equality include treating everyone with respect, accepting people's differences, and being educated about racism and inequality. To start with, treating everyone with respect is a great way to help with equality. For example, including everyone in activities like a game or letting other people other than my friend join in on stuff. I can make sure everyone has a turn when playing games or in a group project. Another way I can treat people with respect is being kind. If I'm able to be kind to everyone, then everyone will be happy. Next, accepting people's differences is a way I can show equality. To do this, I simply don't judge someone based on their looks or culture. Everyone is different and won't look the same. If the whole world constantly judged people like that, it wouldn't be a very fun place to live in. Instead, I try to look past all that stuff and treat people based on their personality and accept them. Finally, I can learn about racism and inequality. Since I'm only in 6th grade, I can't do anything too extreme. But I can educate myself about the things that are going on in our world that aren't very fair. For example, Black Lives Matter is a huge statement that talks about police brutality. If I teach myself about it, and I can better understand what people are going through and understand more about how people are getting treated unfairly. Even just having some knowledge about what's happening can help me treat people equally. I can also educate others about what's going on right now so they can understand too. Overall, it will take a long time for everyone to be treated equally, but I can try and treat everyone equally by giving everyone the same amount of respect, accepting the differences people have, and teaching myself about inequalities in our society. We still have a long way to go in our world, but if everyone makes an effort to treat other people the right way, we have a chance.
Congratulations to our junior school level winners. Junior school special merit fine art winner, Cecilia Bonso, an 8th grader in Ms. Feinster's class at Ridge Junior School. Junior school English language learner, fine art winner is Usman Ahmad, a 7th grader in Mrs. Pfeiffer's class at Hopewell Junior School. The junior school fine art winner was a group project submitted by Kara Simon, Kaylee Helton, Kyra Smith, and Sarang Bach, all in Mrs. Weber's 8th grade class at Hopewell Junior School. Junior school special merit winner is Constance Stevenson, an 8th grader in Mrs. Weber's class at Hopewell Junior School. Junior high English language learner winner was Ahmad Salem, an 8th grader in Mrs. Weber's class at Hopewell Junior School. Our overall junior school winner, Alexis Zimmerman, an 8th grader in Mrs. Fafarik's class at Hopewell Junior School.
Hi, my name is Usman Ahmed. I'm from Mrs. Fafarik's class, and I won the MLK project. I'm here to read my poem to you, Dr. King's Dream, by Usman Ahmed. Once a black man rose from segregation, like a little petal falling from a rose. He fought for equal rights and justice everywhere. People stopped him like a jungle burning down and approaching slowly to a single rose, but didn't complete his mission fully. Then people from all over the country wanted to complete his mission of equal rights and justice, like a garden blooming from all directions. The end.
One, We have a dream.
That color doesn't define our worth.
That the way you speak doesn't make you trashy.
That the way you dress doesn't change your culture.
That the way you carry yourself doesn't make you
whitewashed.
We have a dream.
That we will be judged by our character and not our characteristics.
Your insides mean more than your outward appearance.
Yet some people still cease to realize it.
Though it sounds simple,
others are still stuck in the past.
While people continue to be harassed,
we have a dream.
That one day I will not have to pray that my little brother comes home safely.
We have a dream.
That one day I will be called by my name and not by some label.
We have a dream.
That one day white privilege won't exist.
That one day racial slurs won't be used by ignorant little boys who don't know a speck of history behind them. We have a dream.
That I will be given the same opportunities as my white peers.
Though I'm white,
we have friends that go through these struggles on the daily.
Martin Luther King has created many valuable messages.
We can carry on these messages
by speaking out
and supporting him as well.
Today we celebrate the day Martin Luther King ended racism. Though we still have racism in the United States today, Martin Luther King tried to stop racism for all people. Though people are still getting treated badly, separated from their families, and they're being judged for their skin color for no reason. Martin Luther King ended racism, though we still have it today. Martin Luther King Jr. was a man who believed in trying to end racism in the United States. I can carry out these principles by educating people in our school about racism, by hanging posters around the school, and on the posters they can say that we need to stop judging people about their color and race. I can also start a social media page on racism. The first thing I could do to end racism is educating our school and teaching them about racism. Some young adults who are trying to change the world are the Girl Scouts. The Girl Scouts have a quote about racism, and it says, "Don't be scared about racism, even if it makes you uncomfortable." This quote means that the Girl Scouts are trying to make a difference in our world, and they are speaking out in the world like other young adults who are doing the same thing. Young adults all over the world are trying to educate their school and teach other people outside their school. I can speak out to the school on racism and encourage students to speak out in their community. I can speak out in Westchester and tell them that judging people on their race isn't stopping anything, so they need to stop and accept them for who they are. The second thing I can do to end racism is talk to my principal, Mr. Ruff, and tell him I can make posters that say we need to stop judging people about their skin color and accept them for who they are. Some things I could put on the posters by examples of racism are: accept everyone who is a different race, even if they are a different color than you. Honor black people because they are just as important as you. These are some sayings that I could put on posters and hang them up around the school. My posters will have explanations about racism and what you can do to stop racism in the world today. The third thing I could do is create a social media page about racism. On the page, I could put explanations about racism. I could also put some pictures on the page showing racism in different situations of racism. I could also put a quote about racism from Martin Luther King. I refuse to accept the view that mankind is so tragically bound to the starless midnight of racism and war that the bright daybreak of peace and brotherhood can never become a reality. I believe that unarmed truth and unconditional love will have the final world. This is a quote that I could put on the page about racism. This quote means that he is saying that racism is happening all over the world, and there's nothing we can do to stop it. Martin Luther King was a very good man who ended racism, though we still have other people who treat people who have a different race than them. I can carry out these principles by using my knowledge that I know about racism. The three things I can do are talk to my principal about making and hanging up posters about racism, create a social media page about racism, and I can educate my school and teach them about racism. So if you see someone who is being let down or judged just because of racism, tell the person who's bullying that person to come with you and teach them about racism. Thank you very much.
When Martin Luther King Jr. said, "There comes a time when silence is betrayal," he was expressing how important it is to fight injustice instead of staying silent. Martin Luther King Jr. lived this quote by speaking out against racism and inequality. He delivered many speeches and wrote letters against the injustice that was going on in the world. that can continue his journey of equal rights by treating everyone equally and working on a program at my school to inspire others to do the same. Martin Luther King's journey to fight racism is not finished, but I can continue his work by starting a program at my school to inspire others to treat each other equally. I've had a personal experience with racism. I'm an 8th grade student from Egypt. I'm Muslim and I'm in the ESL program. I had to experience racism from other students making fun of my religion. I can start a program by inviting teachers and students in the school from other countries and from other religions. And we try to discuss about differences and similarities and how people treat each other and discuss about teachers that see racism in the classroom and don't speak out or say something to the student because they don't want to make it a big deal. Mario Blink, a race and cultural columnist for Psychology Today, stated, "Ongoing these conversations of racism and bias will help young students, even for educators who worry about disrupting their curriculum. Their silence can be more destructive than anything else. This quote supports the beliefs of Martin Luther King Jr. as well as myself. I believe in going racist people is a bad solution. People must face these problems and solve them by talking. Martin Luther King Jr. was a man who fought for civil rights and racism. I can help to carry on Dr. King's movement in many ways. I could start a program by inviting teachers and students in this quote from other countries and other religions, and we try to discuss our differences and similarities and how people treat each other. Another thing that I could do is discuss seeing racist people make that racist and not speaking out about it or saying something to the person who is racist. If Martin Luther King were alive today, he would be unsatisfied and try to continue his journey to stop racism.
Spread Dr. King's word. The time is always right to do what is right. That was by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is a significant man in our history and society today. He has made a meaningful impact as Dr. King yearned for everyone to be treated with respect and to be treated equally. We must continue what he started as it is still not done. Using my abilities today, with the knowledge and resources, I can help accomplish what he desires to be done in my community through social media, online websites, and blogs. And peaceful protests spread by the news and worldwide TV. To begin with, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. desired for everyone to be treated equally, and many people in our society are still not being treated equally. We can help Dr. King achieve his goal for everyone to be treated equally with social media. Earlier this year, we had the hashtag Black Lives Matter movement because the people of a different race were and still are being treated unequally and killed because of it. According to BBC.com, a slogan chanted by tens of thousands around the world, Black Lives Matter has sparked a hashtag, a network of grassroots organizations, and a moral collective of activists. As a result, many people learned about this worldwide problem and joined in the fight against it, and we can use it to spread more awareness. It is a very effective and peaceful way to bring attention to something big. Social media is just one way that I can carry out Dr. King's principles of equality. Second, I can assist Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in his goals by starting peaceful protests. Dr. King also did this, but today we have the news and TV that can help spread the peaceful protests and get more people to join and help spread the work of Dr. King. Looking back, Dr. King's main way of spreading his message was by peaceful protests and speeches. For example, the news northeastern.edu simply states, in fact, peace was strategically used during the civil rights movement to emphasize the violence black people in the U.S. endured. Protesters were intentionally peaceful to prevent any questions of who started the violence and whether it was justified. All in all, peaceful protests broadcasted on the TV news can contribute to spreading the word of the harm that would come to people of different races. And by showing that, it created an emphasis on the subject, which is why we can help end this justice just like Dr. King. To sum up my thoughts, I can, in this era of our society, start peaceful protests to make sure Dr. King's goals will be achieved. Finally, one last way that I can help spread and carry out Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s principles today is by creating websites or blogs about equality. and the fairness of everyone, no matter their gender, race, or what they believe in. I can spread Dr. King's goals by creating a website that others can join and comment on, or blogs to help bring communities together and talk about inequality and injustices of our world. For instance, it expresses in the article WiredImpact.com, a website makes it possible for people to reach out and join in your efforts when they stumble across you on the web through related topics or interest in your cause. In other words, websites are a good way to communicate and get supporters for a topic, which is a very significant way that can help achieve Dr. King's goals. Using websites and blogs is one last way I can promote the principles of Dr. King. In closing, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is a significant man in our world, and his goals have still not been accomplished today. And that is why we are here to help do that for him and finish what has been started. We focus on helping Dr. King carry out his principles by peaceful protests, using social media, and creating websites and blogs. These are just a few out of many ways that we can achieve this. We must continue to fight peacefully for what is right and true. When it's all said and done, just remember what Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. declared: I have a dream.
And now we are proud to recognize our high school level winners. High school special merit fine art winner, Christy Rosa, a junior in Mrs. Kessler's class at Lakota West.
Hello, my name is Christy Rosa, and I'm in Ms. Kessler's class, and I did the word letters in dream and the reason I did it was because it was for I Have a Dream and Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech.
High school English language learner, fine art winner, Alex Afari, a junior in Mrs. Kessler's class at Lakota West.
My name is Alex. I submitted a project in Mrs. Kessler's class of my classmate hand in my hand for the Martin Luther King contest. I picked love because love makes people feel equal.
High school fine art winner Chance Gray, a junior in Mrs. Kessler's class at Lakota West. High school English language learner winner Pralad Rima, a freshman in Mrs. Hewitt's class at Lakota East Freshman.
Reinventing Reforms, Martin Luther King Day by Pralad Rima. Prompt: how might you carry out these principles today using your abilities, knowledge, and the resources of this era? Many of the principles shown by Martin Luther King Jr. can still be followed today. His ideas were to reach racial equality through the means of protest and civil disobedience. His ideas are not so radical that it's not possible to implement them or to use them the current day. Things such as civil disobedience can be practiced on anything we think is not fair. The age of the person used flexing their rights does not matter in this case. Someone who is my age or even younger can use this to protest something that they think is wrong, such as a crime or a murder. Something else that Dr. Martin Luther King had practiced is protesting through the means of nonviolence. Doing things such as marching through the streets or holding up signs against an establishment that they believe has unfair practices. This is something anyone of all ages can do, even just acting upon these principles by not supporting groups who might target certain people for who they are. One way that we can stop these injustices is by spreading information and volunteering to help out in efforts, in person or out of person. These are all things that we could have done back a long time ago, such as in Martin Luther King's era. What can we do now using new technologies? Well, we can use the internet. Through the rapid advancement of technology and the internet, it's become a lot easier to spread awareness and information. People can organize a lot easier and start their own movements. For example, Twitter can be used just as effectively as going on TV or trying to write a piece in the newspaper. Many people will see it in the same notoriety as they would have through those means. These are all things that can help shape society by spreading information.
Our overall high school winner, Sydney Zavila, a ninth grader in Miss Hewitt's class at Lakota East.
Sydney Zavila, grade 9, the time is now. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. This is what Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said to more than 250,000 people during his I Have a Dream speech in 1963. While his dream has begun to come true, humanity still has much work to do to complete it. We need to step up, speak out, and use our abilities to educate ourselves and fulfill his dream. The discrepancies between races are beginning to become more and more apparent, and it's time to put an end to it. As I said before, it's time to step up. I am going to do this by learning my privileges. White privilege is unfortunately a very real thing, no matter how many people deny it. The time has come to rise up and admit it is real. If we don't, then it's going to continue to be an issue. When I learn about my privilege and how much I truly have, I can then use it for the better. I can get help for people who need it and make sure they are not being treated differently because of the way they look. We can do this by speaking out against racial inequality. One way I and all of us can carry out this principle is as simple as calling out and stopping racist jokes and statements. These type of jokes are not funny or okay. It is not acceptable to make a joke out of something a person is going through or what they look like, regardless of their skin color or ethnicity. Another way we can help fulfill Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s dream is by properly educating ourselves, especially nowadays when we don't even need to get out of bed to look something up. I will educate myself by paying attention to my own bias against people in general and try and figure out where it stems from. Examining my own bias and figuring out why I act in certain ways will help me better understand myself and other people. Only until I know why I feel a certain way will I be able to help myself grow out of those habits if they do originate from bad stereotypes. This is a major way I can ensure I am racially equal. The divide is only going to continue to grow if we don't do anything about racial inequality. It is time to end it. I urge you to also step up, speak out, and educate yourself in any way possible. Even if you don't go out and start a revolution, every mind that better understands that all men should be treated equally moves humanity one step closer to demolishing racial inequality. Just as Martin Luther King Jr. said, injustice for one is injustice for all.
A big congratulations to this year's grand prize winners. Grand prize fine art winner, Ed Bolden, a senior in Miss Kessler's class at Lakota West. Our overall grand prize winner was Caroline King, an eighth grader in Mrs. Faferick's class at Hopewell Junior School.
Hi, I'm Caroline King. I am the Martin Luther King Jr.'s essay winner. Wow. And I'm representing Hopewell Junior, and my essay is called Speak Up. So here it is. There have been countless speeches in American history given by statesmen, presidents, and activists. Rarely are those speeches remembered. Even more rare if they are seen as iconic. On August 20th, 1963, in front of the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C., Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. gave such a speech. King's famous I Have a Dream speech will inspire future generations to think about freedom and equality for all mankind throughout the world. Dr. King's career as a spiritual leader and social activist reached a high point on that summer afternoon in our nation's capital. The stage was set for him to deliver the words of inspiration and change, and our world took notice. The civil rights movement that King championed through peace and civil disobedience helped shift the culture to inclusiveness and equality for all. Today, we look back and see if those ideas Dr. King shared in his dream became reality and how my generation can continue to foster the legacy of equality and fairness for all. Although I do not see myself giving a speech like Dr. King, there are resources in my bubble that I can help bring awareness to systematic racism. Living in the modern technology age, communicating and influencing possible millions of people in real time can be very impactful. Having the system in place does not ensure your message is received or even influenced the right way. Playing to my talents in education, I can speak up for those who may not have a voice. The recent Black Lives Matter movement is a good example of that. While in social studies class, I was seated next to four African American friends when another classmate wearing a Blue Lives Matter mask walked by and stopped to speak to our group. My knowledge of how the Blue Lives Matter movement culturally appropriated the Black Lives Matter and made it political and not about equality but exclusion. I can see how uncomfortable my group was, and I took the classmate aside to share why his mask was divisive. I told him that the Black Lives Matter movement is simply for equal treatment, not meant to divide us socially or politically. They do not mean to say only Black Lives Matter and no one else's. Their movement addresses systematic racism that exists in law enforcement and legal systems. and they want fairness and equality, not special treatment. I also shared that the Blue Lives Matter is offensive to my non-white friends because it erodes the Black Lives Matter message, uses political and justification for continued indifferences for their plight. After hearing this, my classmate shared that they did not know how it made others feel and how he would reverse his mask to hide the message. After this encounter, my friends thanked me because they had similar situations that they did not speak up for. In my experience, social media can be a sounding board for good, but the potential for negative is just as present. Even though Dr. King had the medium of radio and television, it would take much more to change hearts and minds. Smartphones, Facebook, Instagram, and other media platforms can share the message of equality, but it is the one of one encounters done in love and understanding that fosters real change. Dr. King used to do this all too well. However, he also knew that not all believed in the same God. To your faith or non-faith, it did not fall on deaf ears. In my opinion, the best use of our technology in this era may be to share the positive messages of change, but the real work is to continue the vision of Dr. King, is to spend time with those who are open to learn and heal our nation's racist wounds of 150 years. Sometimes a dream or a vision by one person can turn into a global movement. And I must understand that although I am only one, that one can influence many for good.
Thank you to everyone who took the time to participate in this year's contest. We are proud of all of our students for getting involved.
2020 has been a difficult year for all of us. It's important that we remember during the difficult time of pandemic that we are called to be community together, that we are called to listen to one another. Our next guest, our keynote speaker, Chuck Mingo, is the founder of Undivided, a program that takes participants through life-changing moments of racial healing. Through his passion for justice and racial reconciliation, Chuck has transformed Undivided from a congregational training into a national movement with hub cities emerging throughout the country. Chuck's leadership through Undivided has inspired and mobilized thousands from diverse backgrounds around the nation. Reaching beyond church walls, Undivided has even extended into prisons and internationally to South Africa. Chuck's message is more important now more than ever with the difficulties that we have been facing. We welcome Chuck Mingo.
Hi, I'm Chuck Mingo, and it is an honor to be with you and the Westchester community to celebrate the life and legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I have to say, it does feel strange to have to do this over a screen, although we are used to that at this point, having experienced what we experienced last year and are still in the midst of with this pandemic. But still, I would love to be with you. I love people, and I would love to be in a room with people thinking about what it means to reflect on the life of Dr. King and to carry on his legacy. I think it's more important this year than it has been in quite some time. A little bit about me. I am a husband to Maria. I'm a father to Nathan, Samuel, and Isabel. I'm a pastor at Crossroads Church, and I am the leader and founder of an organization called Undivided, an organization that ignites and unites people in the work of racial justice, very much following in the footsteps of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And as I think about where we are as a country, I have to tell you that I do think that his legacy is so important and so relevant to this moment we find ourselves in. But I have a question for you, and it's the question I've been thinking about too. What are you called to rise and build in 2021? Now, why am I asking that question? Well, I'm sure you know that Dr. King was a Baptist minister, and he was a great preacher. And I think that Dr. King might be drawing today, if he were in our time and moment, he'd be drawing on the story of Nehemiah, which is an Old Testament biblical character who found himself in a city that he loved, but had been torn to the ground, and the walls of protection of the city were literally rubble all around him. And yet Nehemiah was able to face the rubble, but see what could be. And the moment in the story that's most powerful is when he casts that vision to those around him, and he says to them, "Come, let us rise and build." I think 2020 has left a lot of rubble. The rubble of the pandemic, the way that it's impacted physical lives, human lives, the way that it's impacted us relationally, the way that it's impacted communities economically. There is rubble all around us. And of course, there's the rubble of the division that is our country right now, whether that be racial division or political division or other ways that we're divided. And so around us is a lot of rubble. But we, I believe, do not have to settle for the rubble. But there's an opportunity for us to rise and to build. But it's going to require us, like Dr. King, to lean into some specific commitments. I'm going to give you three commitments to consider as we reflect on his life. The first is the commitment to rise and build through deep relationships. Dr. King gave a speech in 1964 at St. Louis University. And part of that speech were these famous words where he said, "We will either learn to live together as brothers or perish together as fools." I do believe that's the tension that we find ourselves in. What does it look like to forge deep relationships with people who see the world very differently than we do? One of the things we focus on in Undivided is empathy and using that as what we call a superpower to engage in deep relationships with people who see the world differently than we do, whether it be because of their racial or their ethnic or their cultural background or their political point of view. But it's so important that we learn to do this together so that we can build and not perish together. You know, in that vein, I think about Dr. King and how he modeled this through his relationship with Lyndon Baines Johnson, with President Johnson. You know, think about those two. They weren't necessarily peas in a pod. You might not put them together, but the two of them forged a relationship. And out of that relationship came many of the first civil rights legislations that Dr. King had fought so hard to achieve. You know, I don't know how many times they were at the White House together, or how many times they were on the phone together. But I do know that that relationship was one of candor, of challenge, but amidst that, this leaning in for mutual understanding so they could make real and lasting change. And they did. Just consider this. In 1964, the signature of the Civil Rights Act, which dismantled official segregation in the country. Obviously, the 1965 Voting Rights Act, which secured the vote and did away with racist voting laws. And even in 1968, the Civil Rights Act, which impacted housing laws in our country. All of that forged through a friendship that at one point is embodied through this incredible picture where President Johnson gives Dr. King the pen with which he's just signed legislation into law. I think it was a symbol of him saying, we did this together. And so I want us to be thinking in this time when it is easy to be divided, what does it look like to forge deep relationships in the Westchester community, in your workplace, in your home, in your neighborhood, through the civic organizations, at the country, at the county, at the government level? What does it look like to do that? Because I do believe a commitment to deep relationships is one of the ways we will move forward in this moment. Second commitment is a commitment to creative engagement. And I say creative engagement because it's important to remember that the civil rights movement was an embodied movement. It wasn't a movement of philosophy, and it wasn't just a movement of speeches and ideas. It was a movement of marching and organizing and registering people to vote. It was a movement of nonviolent social change where people were willing to go to jail and not resist arrest so that they could make their point that justice for all was the highest good and it was worth embodying and sacrificing. One of the people I've been privileged to meet is Dr. Marshall Gans. And Dr. Gans is a Harvard professor, but he's really a maestro when it comes to community building and organizing people for action. He was a part of the Freedom Summer in the Civil Rights Movement. He was also a part of the work that Cesar Chavez led for farm workers. And so this is a man who understands that. And he reflects on the words of a Jewish rabbi, Hillel. And these are ancient words in the questions. There's three questions that Rabbi Hillel asked. The first question is, if I am not for myself, then who am I? Second question, when I am only for myself, what am I? And then the third question is, if not now, when? The first question is about self. It's about understanding our self-interest. The second question, though, is about others. I can't just be about myself. I have to be in relationship with others and collectively finding a way to coexist, if you will, to be in relationship with each other. And then thirdly, we have to act. We have to embody what we want to see in the world. The civil rights movement was this. Dr. Gans tells a story of being at Miami University, actually not too far from Westchester in Oxford, Ohio, which was a training ground for students in Freedom Summer, where they would learn the principles of nonviolence, and they'd be prepared to then go into the South and to go alongside and work alongside African-American students who were working to register voters in states like Mississippi. And he talks about a moment when the Mississippi burning had happened and the news came to the students that these organizers who were down there, the bodies had been found, they had been killed. It was suspected that they had been killed, but the news was then revealed. And he talked about the leader going to the front of the room and saying, I can't promise you that if you get on a bus and go in the South, you're gonna come back. And he talked about how student after student began to stand up, and how someone began to sing one of the songs that was a part of the civil rights movement at the time. And those students got on that bus. They were willing to embody what it looked like to stand alongside someone else for their freedom and their justice, to not let it just be philosophical, but they let it be physical. I've experienced this myself with Undivided. In 2016, we had the opportunity to organize collectively to pass what was called Issue 44. It was a school levy. And the big part of the levy was providing millions of dollars in additional funds for quality preschool for many kids in our city and community who wouldn't otherwise be able to afford it. And that was a big game-changing thing. And as a pastor at a local church who had not done anything maybe in that space before, I had to make a choice. Would this just be philosophical for me, or would I get physical? And I decided to get physical. I decided to be a spokesperson for the campaign and go on TV and actually say, hey, I think this is a good idea for our community. And I also had the opportunity to see 250 other people in our church community get physical and do phone banks and knock on doors and register voters. And in 2016, that levy passed by an historic margin. Why? Because people chose not to make the work of justice, the work of unity, philosophical. They made it physical. And I think we have to have a commitment to that kind of creative engagement in this moment if we want to see positive change for everyone in our community. And then the third and final commitment is the commitment to courageous love. It wouldn't be a reflection on Dr. King if we didn't read and hear some of his words directly. So I want to read from you from a sermon that he spoke and wrote in 1964 called The Most Durable Power in the Universe. He says, I still believe that love is the most durable power in the world. Over the centuries, men have sought to discover the highest good. This has been the chief quest of ethical philosophy. This was one of the big questions of Greek philosophy. The Epicureans and the Stoics sought to answer it. Plato and Aristotle sought to answer it. What is the summum bonum of life? I think I have discovered the highest good. It is love. This principle stands at the center of the cosmos. I believe that. I believe that so deeply that 6 years ago, I stood on a stage at our church and said, hey, we have to stand undivided. And you know what? We did. And as we did that, we saw people change. We saw communities transform. But I think we're in another moment where all of us collectively, you and me, need to say we are going to pursue courageous love. Courageous love is going beyond the standing ovation. It's going beyond what happens in rooms. It's going beyond even what we're doing right now. It's boots on the ground. It's love in action. Let's be clear. When you pursue courageous love, rarely will people applaud. But it's so essential, and all of us need to be a part of it. Courageous love is about justice and reconciliation. It's about dreaming and doing. It's about all of us collectively as dreamers and doers and reconcilers communicating through our work the good news that everyone is worthy. And so I think in this moment, the challenge for us is the same challenge that Nehemiah posed all those thousands of years ago. Come, let's rise and build. Let's rise and build a better community, a better Westchester, a better Cincinnati region, a better country, a better world by committing to deep relationships and committing to creative engagement, being physical in our search and work for justice and unity for all, and to do so from a spirit of courageous love. I hope that you'll consider these reflections. More importantly, I hope that you'll embody them in the places where you have influence. So I want to thank you for the time, and may we be people who, through our courageous love, make positive change for every citizen. Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us for our virtual Live the Dream event. A special thank you to all of the community leaders who helped put this together, to all of the students who participated in the contest, and congratulations to all of our winners. Looking at the youth of today gives me hope for tomorrow in our continued and difficult work of racial reconciliation. And now receive the benediction. May the one who has created you continue the good work in you, that you may know that you are valued and loved, And may you take that value and love into your community and share that welcome and love with others. Go in peace and serve one another in love. Amen.